strength of the Tongan culture is in the kava. There's no ranking, and people come here as they are. It's actually a way of life for people.
When you look at the kava circle, it's always evolving. What we do now would not have been done 150 years ago. Challenge is, how do we keep the spirit and the
true Pasifika values in a very non-Pasifika area?
There's a common misconception that drinking kava is like drinking alcohol. It's a non-alcoholic beverage. It doesn't impair any of your senses in terms of vision or your sense of space and your timing. It doesn't do that. What kava does is actually gets you to a more relaxed state.
What it allows us to do is to tala noa, to sing, to laugh, and to banter. It's a more relaxed format. It provides for a place for different generations to meet, interact.
I think the reason why it's the only kava club left in the city is, one is because we're fortunate to be one of the only remaining Tongan families in the area, and two is its uniqueness in terms of the music. It looks like we're just drinking kava and singing random songs, and it's not. It's a form of social theatre.
My job on a normal faikava evening is to sense the mood of the people within that kava sitting and be able to make them feel relaxed and then take them on a musical journey throughout Tonga.
The playing of the music that defined the fofo’anga. My dad was, he arranged the music and also played the music when he was in Tonga. When he came here, he was a composer. My dad used to say that the good of the fofo’anga is you come and then you sing songs, and then when you go home, your head is full of songs. You have no more worries because the songs fill up your thinking. And so you let go of the problems and the troubles.
We're at the United Church of Tonga. My family has a very deep history with the church. Both sets of my grandparents on my mum and my dad's side both helped in establishing this church back in the 70s. My grandfather, who started the fofo’anga kalapu here, was also a founding member of this church too. Members who have since passed away, who were part of founding this church, were also a deep part of the fofo’anga kalapu itself.
We had a very marginalised cross-section of Tongan society at the time. They're unemployed, loved their kava music, and they would form at night to drink kava and talk about the day's happenings.
During the time of the dawn raids, people needed a place to socialise and to practice our culture, just like you've seen at our church, practice their religion. So those two things go hand in hand. That's why they started the kalapu.
So my dad, he led the fofo’anga in Tonga before he came. Then he started it in our house. You know, it was only about maybe five or six of them. And then it just grew and grew, and now we have 13 branches throughout New Zealand.
If you look at my family, we provide a house that has been hosting people for 45 years now.
There's a saying that in Tongan, it's fofo’anga talanoe kainga. We roll up the mat each night. That's what my family does. I roll up the mat on the Wednesday nights or whatever night the kava club runs, and whoever comes through that door is open to come and listen to our Tongan music and banter.
You've basically become a proper community hub. The fofo’anga has Tongan language programs. We've got a food bank. We've won music competitions. It's a safe space for youth. It's a safe space for elderly.
There's not enough of our New Zealand-born speaking the Pacific languages. Tongan is no exception. When they come in speaking maybe one or two words in Tongan, after 3 months of being in the kawa, they speak fluent Tongan. Unbelievable. They immerse themselves fully. They speak Tongan, they sing Tongan, they joke around in Tongan. And after 12 weeks or so, they speak the language, not perfectly, but certainly better than when they first came in. Mum and I and my younger sister arrived in 1975 from Tonga. I was 10 years old. There were lots of Tongan families on this street, so we felt quite at home. Sort of middle class, white, you know, wealthy people who come here, and they are very surprised. They always assume that this is a state house, and we're living here as state house residents. They are very surprised when we tell them, it's our property, it's our house. We've been here for 40 years. But there's not quite the warmth, eh? The mafana that was there before. You know, you're wearing your traditional attire on Sundays, and the neighbors initially looked at you in a funny way. Now they understand that, you know, we are Tongan and we live like Tongans and we dress like Tongans.
My grandfather, he was a musician, so he would write songs and also put music to the songs as well. And so they recorded it over a number of years, so 93, and then remastered in 06, which is when I think they recorded this album here, Whakapā o Sāngone. School, if people would ask where do you live, they'd assume we'd live out in South Auckland. It's just a stereotype associated with islanders not being here anymore. I'm glad that we're talking about it a bit more to sort of make the invisible visible, I guess, again. So this is a photo of my grandfather, Saimone Koloamatangi, who also had the cultural matapule title Mafua I Lulutai, and he's the one that started the fofo’anga here in Aotearoa and in 1978. And this is him at church, actually. So it's one of the few kind of photos we have of him. I kind of get the sense he wasn't a big fan of photos either, but maybe that's just me saying that. So, yeah, I miss him. There's a lot of nostalgia attached to having something like this, like a community group still here in the inner city, because a lot of people come back and they used to live here in Grey Lynn or in Ponsonby. It's kind of like a trip down memory lane when they come back here every week. I know some people have misconceptions about the role of women and also the participation of women in something like kava culture. It's not like women don't drink kava. It's just that with the fofo’anga, they don't. And especially in diaspora, you know, it's a little bit different. I've grown up thinking that men hold the authority, but women hold the rank. My auntie is the highest in our family, and my grandfather's sister was the highest as well, you know, who I'm named after. So I think it comes with different responsibilities as well. So I'd always thought it balanced each other out. I think as a Tongan woman, it's actually quite empowering to hold space in your own way. You know, this is their space, and I don't think it takes anything away from me being a Tongan woman to not be a part of kava. And I know there are spaces for Tongan women, we do that as well.
Well, like in the kava circle, its relevance depends on the people who are part of that circle. I think there's a challenge for New Zealand-born Tongans such as myself to carry on the culture. I think that's probably the challenge where the kalapu's at right now is to be constantly evolving, constantly looking to challenge its members to think outside the box.
To be able to hold space for people and to be able to offer this every week, it comes with a lot of responsibility.
The tapestry of the kalapu and its history is constantly being woven. if we were to lose the kalapu and my family wasn't to run it anymore, then the actual ngatu or the tapestry that's been constantly woven into would actually be lost.
Thank you.